Hey guys, and welcome back to my channel for another video in my history series, where today I'm going to tell you a story about possibly one of the most badass women in history. I mean, the pure nerve on this woman is astounding, and after researching for this video, I'm now absolutely obsessed with her. She might be in my top 5 favourite historical figures of all time. It's a travesty that her story isn't more well known, but I'm here in a very small attempt to fix that. Before we get into the video, just a couple of things. I've moved house. I'm currently filming this in my new lounge, but this is a very temporary filming setup. It's very echoey in here. The lighting's a bit dodgy, I'm aware. I'm sorry that it's not the best quality. I am gonna have an office, or I'm gonna have like a permanent camera setup, and hopefully like a cute background and stuff like that. But we're still waiting on loads of the furniture to be delivered for that. So just bear with me for the next couple of weeks whilst I figure out the best place to film and how I'm gonna do it all, and it's all very exciting. But yeah, it is quite echoey in here. I really hope that's not off-putting. I didn't realise till I sat down to film this, but yeah, it's very echoey, but I'm sure you don't mind. And of course, this video is sponsored by Magellan TV. As you probably know, me and Magellan TV have an ongoing sponsorship, and I know that so many of you have already signed up. So today I'm gonna make a couple of documentary recommendations first to see if I can entice you in. First up, we have a documentary called Facebook Follies, The Unexpected Consequences of Social Media, which is a very good look at society's current addiction to social media. How healthy is it to have a constant stream of information and constant communication? What are the consequences of publicly sharing personal information in such a way? It's not always nice to hear bad things about social media. I find I get immediately defensive because I think I'm just immediately wrapped with guilt about it. But it's also very healthy to know the consequences of what you're doing. And the second documentary is called Bacteria Killers, which feeds directly into my very weird fascination with infectious diseases. But luckily, I know that you guys are just as weird as me and you enjoy it just as much as I do. So you'll also enjoy this documentary just as much as I did. It's about something called bacteriophage, which is a virus which actually kills bacteria. So this documentary traces the footsteps of bacteriophage over history to try and understand how they work, and through that, understand how we can use phages in the fight against antibiotic resistance, which is a huge problem. It's a very new science, but it's very fascinating to see how this small thing could change the entire world. And for those of you who haven't signed up yet, Magellan TV is a streaming service dedicated purely to documentaries. They have everything from true crime to science, history, nature, and everything in between, with new programs added weekly to be watched anywhere on your TV, laptop, and mobile. It's compatible with Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Google Play, and iOS, and loads of programs are available in 4K. If you're in the UK right now, which I know a lot of you are, you'll know that we're currently in lockdown 2.0 as of yesterday. And I'm sure you're all gonna be looking for new and exciting ways to entertain yourselves. If you enjoy my channel, then I honestly cannot stress enough how you will enjoy Magellan TV. There's never been a better time to dedicate your time to educating yourself and learning something new. But let's get back to the story. So our story begins over 200 years ago in 1805 with the birth of Mary Jane Grant in Kingston, Jamaica, which at the time was a British colony. No one is sure of the exact date of birth because Mary, being the proud woman that she was, refused to ever disclose it, even in her own autobiography, which was entitled The Wonderful Adventures of Mrs. Seacole in Many Lands. I'm going to be using that book as a reference for much of this video because, well, who better to learn about Mary Seacole from than Mary Seacole herself? Mary's father was James Grant, a Scottish army officer based in Jamaica, and her mother was a free black woman. As much as I searched, it doesn't look like we actually know the name of Mary's mum for sure, so I'm just going to refer to her simply as Mum whenever I need to. Whilst she was half Scottish and half black, Mary's relationship with her identity was not that straightforward. She always avoided identifying herself as a black woman or even as Jamaican. She referred to herself as a Creole, defined now as a person of mixed European and black descent. But back when Mary was growing up, it was not so much a signifier of race as it was to simply describe the Caribbean-born children of white colonists. Mary was particularly proud of her Scotch blood, and although she felt very strongly for the pains of the enslaved people, especially over in America, saying they shed blood, it's very important to remember the context of the times that Mary grew up in. The abolition of the Slave Trade Act happened just 2 years after she was born, and it wouldn't be until 1838, when Mary was 33 years old, that slavery was fully abolished in Jamaica. Although she was never a slave and her mother was a free black woman as well, she, as a Creole woman, would still have been legally and socially discriminated against. But Mary always refused to be put into categories based on the colour of her skin. She never let it limit her, although there would have been limits to the political rights that she had in Jamaica at the time. But she just didn't see her skin colour as a problem, or at least she was never going to let it be a problem. Her autobiography talks about a trip to London in which she was walking down the street with a woman with darker skin than her own. She writes, "The efforts of the London street boys to poke fun at my and my companion's complexion, I am only a little brown, a few shades duskier than the brunettes whom you all admire so much, but my companion was very far and a fair subject for their rude wits." She spoke openly in her autobiography about how she refused to fit the stereotype of the lazy Creole, which is problematic in itself. This, I think, speaks volumes as to how little Mary was going to allow outside perceptions of her affect what she was going to do with her life. She saw herself as powerful and a force to be reckoned with, regardless of the colour of her skin. She wasn't going to let it be a hurdle, and that was something that was ingrained in her from a very early age. Of course, her skin colour would be a hurdle at some point, but it seems that any pushback would just make Mary more determined to succeed. Mary was distinctly proud of her British heritage though, which was something that, like I said, had been instilled in her by her family and the people she was raised by from an early age. Even amongst the free black people in Jamaica, there was a prejudice, an attempt to distinguish themselves from the people held in slavery, to further their own positions in society. The fact that Mary was half British would likely have been an incredibly positive thing for her back in Jamaica, and it would have given her an advantage in Jamaican society over those who were not. As I'm sure it is with a lot of people, Mary's relationship with her own race was very complex, but she sure loved the fact that she could call herself British. Even though she was aware of the colour of her skin, Mary always thought herself an equal to her white counterparts, and she would be horrified when people showed that they did not consider this themselves. The level of self-confidence that this would have required back in the 1800s was astounding. Reading her book, Mary most often refers to herself simply as Creole or even as yellow. And before anyone comes for me, I just want to stress that everything I've just shared about Mary and her relationship with her skin colour was Mary's opinion and not mine, from the words written in her own book. I personally would not describe a person as yellow, but that's how Mary described herself. I think Mary was always very aware of the limitations that were put on her by society if she described herself as a black woman. So therefore she was always either Creole or she was yellow. But she did acknowledge she had black blood, she acknowledged that she was related to the enslaved people in America, but she wasn't about to let those limitations be put on her. But back to Mary's family. So Mum was a very interesting woman, running a lodging house called Blundell Hall in Kingston. Mum was also what was known as a doctress, a very specific role in Jamaican society, that of a doctor, nurse, midwife and herbalist. The techniques of doctresses drew strongly from traditional herbal medicine, and they had very specific knowledge of tropical diseases commonly found on Jamaica, skills acquired from having to look after fellow slaves on the plantations with medical care not being available. In a time when most Western white doctors didn't even wash their hands before seeing patients, doctresses practiced good hygiene, even though germ theory wasn't even a thing yet, and they practiced effective herbal medicine. Doctresses understood the most basic needs of people to recover: hygiene, hydration, rest, and good care. If you watched my Florence Nightingale video from just a few weeks ago, you'll already know that these are the very basics of healthcare nowadays. But it never used to be. Or it never used to be for British healthcare anyway, I should say. Nursing was considered akin to prostitution, and if you did attend some kind of healthcare facility, you'd probably be left to lie on the floor with rats and feces and eventually end up dying. Mum was, in Mary's own words, an admirable doctress, in high repute with the officers of both services and their wives when they were stationed in Kingston. From an early age, Mary would watch and learn traditional medicine from her mother as she treated ill soldiers at Blundell Hall. And from then, Mary decided that she was going to be a doctress herself. It was in her blood. Growing up, Mary would use one of her own dolls as her patients. This poor doll would always just happen to contract whatever the latest disease was in Kingston, and Mary would treat it, always managing to save her poor doll's life. As a young girl, Mary was taken in by an old lady, whose name we also do not know, who brought her up in her own household alongside her own grandchildren. The saying, "It takes a village," springs to mind here. Mary was completely spoiled by this old woman whenever she was staying with her, but would be swiftly brought back down to earth and back to work with her mother. By the age of 12, Mary was working alongside her mother, frequently assisting her in tending to the sick soldiers. And whilst we've covered how proud Mary was of her Scottish heritage, there's actually very little mention of her father in her autobiography, and I couldn't find really any source that gave many answers as to what happened to him. Although it does seem like Mary had two siblings, likely by the same father. So he clearly did stick around in Jamaica for a while. Likelihood is, with him being a British soldier, he had to change base and leave the country eventually, perhaps returning back to Scotland, and she probably didn't see him again. So Mary grew up learning medicine from her mother, but as she got older, she just had this itch that she was desperate to scratch. Mary wanted to travel, and she was desperate to visit Britain, England in particular. She wrote in her autobiography, "I was never weary of tracing upon an old map the route to England, and never followed with my gaze the stately ships homeward bound without longing to be in them." Homeward bound, she said. She considered Britain to be her home despite having never been there. From what I can gather, a trip to England would be nothing more than a pipe dream for most young girls in Jamaica at the time, but Mary was one of the lucky ones. She was able to accompany some relatives to England while she was still a fairly young woman, and stayed there for about a year before returning back to Kingston. But she didn't stay home for long. Now she had the travel bug and she returned to London once again, this time taking a large stock of West Indian preserves and pickles for sale, and she stayed there for 2 whole years. On her return home this time round, she found herself on a ship which actually caught fire out at sea. She writes that she entered into an arrangement with the cook in that if the fire got too bad, he would tie her onto a large hen coop that they had on board in exchange for £2 so she could potentially float and survive. Ever resourceful was Mary Seacole. Over the next year or so, she visits New Providence, Haiti and Cuba, bringing shells home to Kingston to sell. Eventually though, the old woman who raised her got very ill and Mary returns home to nurse her. This woman eventually died in her arms, so now Mary heads to her mother's house where she continues to learn more about old Creole medicine. It's around this time that she ends up engaged to a man called Edwin Horatio Hamilton Seacole, marrying him on the 10th of November 1836. Edwin Seacole had a pretty interesting story himself. His godfather was none other than Admiral Horatio Nelson, and rumours have always persisted that he was actually the bastard son of Nelson himself and one of his mistresses, Emma Hamilton. Which is very interesting, since Edwin's names include both Horatio and Hamilton. The story goes that Edwin was adopted by Thomas Seacole, the surgeon who delivered him, but whether that's true or not remains to be seen. Mary doesn't talk much about her marriage in her book. Of her engagement and marriage, she simply says, "I went to my mother's house where I stayed, making myself useful in a variety of ways and learning a great deal of Creole medicinal art, until I couldn't find courage to say no to a certain arrangement timidly proposed by Mr. Seacole, but married him and took him down to Black River, a town in Jamaica, where we established a store. Poor man, he was very delicate, and before I undertook the charge of him, several doctors had expressed most unfavourable opinions of his health. I kept him alive by kind nursing and attention as long as I could, but at last he grew so ill that we left Black River and returned to my mother's house at Kingston." As far as I could find, we don't know how Mary and Edwin actually met, but considering he was a very ill man, the likelihood is that he was probably a patient of her and her mother's at Blundell Hall. Within just a month of returning back to Kingston, Edwin died in October 1844. In total, they were married for almost 8 years, and she writes that after he died, she didn't stir for days. "Lost to all that passed around me in a dull stupor of despair." So while she doesn't write much of him in her book, it's clear that she did love him very much. That wasn't to be the only tragedy in Mary's life though, as her mother died soon after. And the year before, the family had lost Blundell Hall in the Great Kingston Fire of 1843, which destroyed a tenth of the city. She nearly lost her life in the fire because she refused to leave the house until she'd done everything she could to save it. And now Mary was completely alone in the world. She was a widow, but she refused to feel sorry for herself and just continued full steam ahead. Blundell Hall was rebuilt and restocked as new Blundell Hall, and Mary said it was even better than before, because now she had her own great reputation as a doctress independent of her mother. New Blundell Hall was always full of sick officers and their wives, sometimes even having military doctors and surgeons visiting her, at which point Mary would learn as much as she possibly could from them thanks to their kindness and readiness to share their knowledge. The soldiers she treated would affectionately refer to Mary as Mother Seacole, even though she was younger than a high number of them. These soldiers, an ocean away from their mothers and their families, were treated as one of her own by Mary Seacole. Not only was she nursing them back to health, but she also always had an ear to listen. She called them her sons. A lot of these men were probably starved of affection, and Mary provided that in buckets. And a lot of the men really took a shine to her. There's a really funny line in her book that says, "Indeed, I do not mind confessing to my readers in a friendly, confidential way that one of the hardest struggles of my life in Kingston was to resist the pressing candidates for the late Mr. Seacole's shoes." This woman had an incredible sense of humour, clearly, but she never took up any of the men on their offer. I think she was very content being a widow. She'd done the marriage thing and now she just had other goals in mind. She was happy just being Mother Seacole and caring for her boys. In 1850, Mary's brother left Kingston for Panama, where he'd set up a store and a hotel of his own. Mary said that she'd recently been trying to fight off the travel bug again, but she wasn't having much luck with it. So she persuaded herself that her brother needed a help in Panama, because as she writes, he was far from strong. And so she makes a journey across to Panama to join him. Before she leaves Jamaica, Mary has tailors make up clothes, coats and trousers, and sets people to work in her kitchen making jellies and preserved meats to take across to Panama with her, knowing that the journey over there would be a very difficult one consisting of trains, boats and carts. Mary was travelling with her black servant Mac and a little girl. At one point they were attempting to hire a boat, but they struggled because of the large crowds and the fact that Mary was travelling with a black woman. At this point she is incredibly critical of Americans, saying that she did indeed have prejudice against the Americans, writing, "I have a few shades of deeper brown upon my skin which shows me related, and I am proud of the relationship to those poor mortals whom you once held enslaved and whose bodies America still owns." It's very interesting because at some points in her book you'd be forgiven for thinking that she did all she could to try and avoid being referred to as a black woman. But here she clearly identifies with her blackness and is very proud of it. She can't seem to stand the superiority that many Americans seem to think they have over her and others because of the colour of their skin. This just intense dislike of American people that comes through in her book multiple times is just really funny to me. She just really did not like the Americans, and she particularly hated the impatience they showed towards black people. This woman, Mary Seacole, was never going to let anything get in her way. I can picture her rolling her eyes at these racist people and just pushing them aside. She gave zero fucks. When she finally arrived at her brother's house in Cruces, the independent hotel, she was very disappointed. It was nothing but a low hut filled with mud and split bamboo. It was filthy and filled with people. Mary was thoroughly unimpressed with the amount of Americans staying there as well, and she was furious at her brother for not having a room ready for her. In fact, there were barely even any rooms at all. Most visitors just slept in the common areas. So Mary made herself comfy, but she was not happy about it. But soon she would be put to good use in Cruces though, when a bout of cholera broke out and she was left to treat the sick as there was no local doctor. Luckily for them, she carried her medical kit with her everywhere she went. And Mary operated on a basis of good faith. She expected those who could afford to pay to do so, and they often did do so handsomely. But the majority of her patients couldn't afford anything. She knew this and she would only expect their thanks in return. Through this, she made a name for herself and people would travel for hours to get her help. One night, a man did just that, taking Mary to his home a short distance from town where men were dying. Some of the patients were past the point of health, Mary commenting that only death could bring them relief, but she did what she could to save the rest. One particular patient that caught her attention was that of a poor orphan baby, barely a year old, which died in her arms and there was nothing she could do to help except pray. It was something that would probably never cross the minds of most, especially at this time, but Mary knew that if she could find out exactly why this baby had died, that she might be able to save the lives of the rest. She bribed the man who took the baby's body away to bury it, and she did her first ever and last ever post-mortem examination. Mary doesn't say in the book exactly what it is she learned from this exam, but she did say it was decidedly useful. Knowing what little I know about cholera, she probably saw a huge amount of dehydration, just this lack of water in the baby's body. From then on, she adjusted her remedies accordingly. She would use opium to relax the patients and stop the bodies from exerting too much. She would give them water boiled with cinnamon or water boiled with sugar. She kept the bodies warm with mustard poultices and knew not to stop with her treatment even when the patients seemed to be improving. But then of course, Mary came down with cholera herself. Luckily her own illness was mild and she improved very quickly. The local people all came to her aid just as she had come to theirs. Once Mary recovered, she set her sights on a small hut opposite her brother's hotel. It was rotting with only two rooms, but she described it as a charming residence and soon began renting it. She decorated and prepared to accommodate up to 50 guests at a time. It made me laugh that she was so horrified at her brother's hotel being packed with guests when she arrived, but now she's bought the hut opposite to do the same with it. I'm sure her brother was over the moon with Mary buying a property so close to his as well. I don't know if he even invited her to Panama in the first place. I got the impression that she just wanted to go, so she did. He was probably pretty exasperated about her. Mary named her new business the British Hotel, but it wasn't to be a lodging house despite the name. It was going to be a restaurant, essentially. Just somewhere people can go to eat food, have company. There was even a barber's, I think she got eventually. She decorated her hut with calico of gayest colours and stripes and exuberance of fringes, frills and bows, commenting that the Americans love show dearly. She also says, as I said, she hired a barber for the British Hotel, saying, "You can scarcely conceive the pleasure and comfort an American feels in a clean chin." Mary just really did not like the Americans, but she squeezed every single penny out of them that she could. She also comments on how much coffee the American men seem to drink, and says that she started putting salt in the drinks after the sixth or so cup to get them to stop and leave her restaurant, because apparently they'd just sit there all day drinking so many cups of coffee. After a while in cruises, Mary makes the decision to travel down to Gorgona, where she seems to go a little bit late for the season and can only find this miserable little hut for sale which she buys for $100. She very briefly runs a female-only hotel before travelling back to Jamaica in late 1852. It was on this journey back to Jamaica that Mary encountered yet more discrimination for the colour of hers and her servant's skin. American white women refused to travel with them in the same saloon. So Mary goes to the stewardess, who I think she expected to side with her, but was appalled when she just questioned her extensively about how and why she was on the boat, saying that she couldn't expect to stay with the white people. One British man there advised Mary to stand her ground and not leave her seat for any of them, to which the stewardess simply said, "If the Britishers is so took up with coloured people, that's their business, but it won't do here." So Mary actually had to disembark, they weren't going to go with her on it. But 2 days later, she ended up taking passage with a British boat, on whom she knew the captain, and she eventually reached Kingston, where she would stay for the next 8 months. In that 8 months, a bout of yellow fever broke out, and Mary's house was full of people suffering. This was the worst thing she'd ever witnessed. It was the white people travelling in from Britain who were most affected, and not used to the climate and tropical conditions of Jamaica. Mary was left to console the loved ones when young people died in their hordes. Soon though, she had to return to Panama to wind up her business there, and then she opened up a store in Navy Bay for just 3 months, and then she moved to Escribanos. She is possibly one of the most restless women I've ever learned about. Even in the time before air travel, when travel was incredibly difficult, Mary was here, there and everywhere. She wasn't going to sit still for long. For the last time she'd been in Jamaica, Mary had heard about a war that had broken out in the Crimea. To steal directly from my Florence Nightingale script, As a quick explanation, the Crimean War was fought between 1853 and 1856, in which Russia eventually lost the Ottoman Empire, which was the UK, Sardinia and France. In no shock to anyone, it was a war fought over religion. Mary had heard that many of the regiments, the men that she'd made friends with, the men that she'd cared for in Kingston, had been sent to fight over the Crimea, as she desired to go and join them, to continue caring for them. She was Mother Seacole and she needed to be there for her sons. So she heads back to England in the autumn of 1854 with the aim of joining the war efforts, using her skills as a doctress to help the soldiers over there fighting. No one understood why she'd want to actively go to a war zone and help over there. But by this point, we all know that once Mary gets an idea in her head, no one is going to stop her. She knew that she had the funds to get to Turkey, but knew that she couldn't keep going for long once she was there. So she needed to come up with a plan. Apologies for horrendous lighting in this video, I'm very hyper aware of it and it's actually making me want to scream a little bit, but there's not much I could do about it right now, so I'm sorry. Okay, back to the video, okay. If you've watched my Florence Nightingale video already, and if you haven't, you probably should, you'll know that the conditions in hospitals in the Crimea were dire. More men were dying of preventable illnesses than they actually were on the front line. The hospitals were disgusting. Men would lie on hay on the floor with the rats and feces. Nursing wasn't really a thing back then until Florence Nightingale came around, as she started to actually care and check on the soldiers throughout the night, which was a crazy idea for the time. And I'm not making this video to compare Mary and Florence. They were two incredibly different women with incredibly different missions at the end of the day. Florence wanted to be a nurse. She wanted to change what it meant to be a nurse. She just happened to end up in the Crimea and she succeeded in that mission of hers. Mary wasn't so much bothered about making a difference in the field of nursing. She wasn't even a nurse, she was a doctress. She just wanted to go to the Crimea and look after her boys. She felt like they needed Mother Seacole. Mary was a mother figure. Florence absolutely was not. Florence was actually probably quite harsh, straight to the point. She just wanted to do a job and save lives, which she did very well. But Mary was kind and warm and loving, and these men were her sons. I think it's only natural that people compare the two. It's especially interesting to compare how both their stories went down in history. But at the end of the day, they were just on very different missions. It just so happened that their paths and stories would cross. It was well known to everyone in Britain the state of the hospitals over in the Crimea, and it was well advertised that they needed more nurses. Mary writes, "I'd seen much of sorrow and death elsewhere, but they had never daunted me, and if I could feel happy binding up the wounds of quarrelsome Americans and treacherous Spaniards, what delight should I not experience if I could be useful to my own sons, suffering for a cause it was so glorious to fight and bleed for." So her first idea, and the obvious one, was to apply to the War Office in London for the post of hospital nurse. She knew of and understood cholera, diarrhoea and dysentery, all things the soldiers were struggling with, and she knew that because of this she could be really helpful to not only the nurses but the doctors too. She even got people who knew and had worked with her to write testimonials attesting to her skills. But the War Office wouldn't even give her an interview, instead transferring her to the Quartermaster General's Department, who then transferred her to the Medical Department. Each time she'd just get brushed off. So she changed tact. Mary had heard recently that Florence Nightingale had left England for the Crimea, and that a team of nurses was soon to follow. She was going to simply ask if she could join, assuming that she would be the perfect candidate. They would jump at the chance to have her. So she goes to the Secretary at War's private address and just waits at his house to ask him. She just goes and waits to speak to him, waiting hours on separate days, saying that all of the noble men walking in and out marvelled exceedingly at the yellow woman who no excuses could get rid of. No matter how many people tried to like get rid of her, she just wouldn't. But she does eventually give up when she received a message saying they didn't need any more nurses for the team. So it kind of worked, she waited until she got an answer. So she tries again, this time getting an interview with one of Florence's companions, getting the brush off again. Apparently she got the feeling that even if there were vacancies available, they wouldn't have given it to her. So her last resort was to apply to the managers of the Crimean Fund, just to see if they could pay for her to get to the camp, hoping that when she was there, she could figure something out. But of course, this failed again. This poor woman, all she wanted to do was go and help, but nobody would let her. And she didn't want to believe that the problem was the colour of her skin. It seems she believed racism to be more of an American issue than British. She just didn't think it would be a problem for her in London. But it clearly was. But Mary wasn't about to let that be a barrier, even though everyone else seemed to let it be. She just fought on and decided that she was going to do it herself, which she should have done in the first place. She was going to open a hotel in the Crimea in her own way, even though she had no idea what to expect. She prints out cards and sends them across to her friends in Sebastopol, a city in the Crimea. Basically just these cards announcing her upcoming arrival in the area, saying that she would start her passage by ship on the 25th of January. She intended to arrive in Balaclava to establish a hotel and a comfortable quarters for sick and convalescent officers. It was basically, get ready sons, Mother Seacole is on her way. She invested the little money she had in medicines that she thought would be of use and connected with a man called Mr. Day, who was a relative of her late husband, who she'd been acquainted with in the Caribbean. Mr. Day was in the shipping business, and together they decided to open a store in the Crimea, as well as a hotel in the neighbourhood of the camp. Obviously, on the long journey, the ship had to make stops, and whilst on a stop in Gibraltar, she ran into two officers who she knew. They were on their journey home, and they exclaimed, "Why, bless my soul, old fellow, if this is not our good old Mother Seacole." A ship halfway around the world, and she was being recognised. The impact that she made on these soldiers back in Kingston is amazing. They actually tried to dissuade Mary from joining the efforts, telling her how awful the conditions were over there, even though the men were very starved of motherly affection, as she replied that nothing would stop her going to help her boys. She also stopped in Scutari on the way, which is where Florence Nightingale and her hospital was. Mary was tired and needed a bed for the night after deciding that it wasn't safe to travel through the night. So she decides to find Florence, handing over a letter to what I assume might have been an assistant of Florence's. This assistant questions Mary about her stay, thinking that she's angling for employment. And Mary simply replies, "Excuse me, ma'am, but I am bound for the front in a few days." Eventually, Florence agrees to see Mary in person, to which she asks what they can do for her, saying that if it was in her power, she would help. Mary replies saying she just wants a bed for the night, to which Florence obliges, giving her a bed in the washerwoman's quarters. As far as history tells us, this was the only time the two women ever met in person, and it seemed to be a pretty nice meeting. Florence did help Mary out. So back Mary goes to the ship for the final leg of the journey to Balaclava. She finds a site for a hotel at a place just down the road from the British camp near Sebastopol, collecting metal and wood that she found on the side of the road to use as building supplies. She hired local labour to build the hotel, and thus the new British hotel opened in March 1855, built for less than £800. She stocked the building with the items she'd bought from Britain, as well as local produce, selling literally anything from a needle to an anchor. There was a kitchen which provided meals to passers-by, and despite constant thefts by locals, her hotel was a very popular one and her business boomed, meaning she could focus the rest of her energy on helping the sick who came to her. And they came in hordes to Mary for three reasons. One, the hospitals were in terrible condition and it was essentially a death sentence to get sent to hospital. Two, they could get all of the comforts and nourishing food they wanted at Mother Seacole's, as she ran the general store and the hotel, which was essentially a hospital but also not. It wasn't a hotel in the sense as we know them today. And three, Mary understood the diseases in a way that most doctors did not. I'm also sure there was an element of actually being cared for if they went to see Mother Seacole as opposed to an actual doctor. She was a comfort to them, thousands of miles from home, they just wanted somebody to mother them. And the soldiers were so grateful for her, they would buy her fruit and leave it outside the store for her. She kept note of each and every soldier she ever helped, and she never, ever forgot a face. Occasionally, she would even visit the battlefield as she was situated so close to the front line where she was. Even under fire, she would go onto the field to nurse the wounded. Mary Seacole perhaps wasn't saving as many lives as Florence Nightingale, but she was providing morale, something that's importance cannot be understated in the time of war. She was kind and generous, she was a comfort to the sick, she kept the soldiers going, and her herbal remedies and medicines did work, she knew what she was doing. A lot of people dismiss her because she wasn't a proper nurse, but to do so dismisses hundreds of years of natural medicine and knowledge. These were tried and tested techniques used in Jamaica for centuries, and Mary actually had a lot of experience doing what she did. Eventually in 1856, the Crimean War came to an end, and of course Mary was one of the last British people to return home. First she had to sell off everything, all of her stock and building materials that she'd used for the hotel, and so she held an auction. Or at least she auctioned off everything that Russians hadn't already stolen. She was furious that even the stuff she did save to auction off ended up going to the Russians, who bid very little for very expensive items. Cheese, which cost 10 pence a pound, was sold for less than a penny a pound. Wine they'd paid 48 shillings for a dozen was sold for just 4 shillings. She was furious and so ended up snatching hammer off the ground and destroying everything, whilst the bystanders held out their hands to catch pieces that flew off. There were no British people or allies left to sell it to, and she said that she'd rather not give it all to the enemies for little money, so she just destroyed all of her stuff. On the journey home, she stopped off at places across Europe to see her men, and finally arrived back in England both poorer in finance and health than she was when she'd left 3 or so years earlier. She regretted nothing, only feeling pride at what she'd done. She attempted to open another store a day in Aldershot, but ended up failing miserably. She was left with very little to show for her efforts, eventually even having to appear in bankruptcy court. The press did pay attention though, because so many soldiers returned home speaking of nothing but kindness about Mother Seacole. She had also made some very notable friends in the Crimea, including Queen Victoria's own nephew, Count Glycan. In 1857, a fundraising gala was held in Mary's honour over 4 nights on the banks of the River Thames. Over 80,000 people attended to help Mary get back on her feet. And it was around the same time that the autobiography that has been such a wonderful source for this video was published. Also that very same year, she petitioned the Secretary of War to let her go over to India to help the wounded over there. But she was dissuaded. Mary could just never relax, she couldn't take the help and the money, she just wanted to go back to war. When the aftermath of the war settled, Mary returned home to Jamaica, where she became a very prominent figure, but she soon ran out of money again. The Seacole Fund was put back in action in London, where many people donated once again, including several members of the British royal family. She was able to buy new land in Kingston before eventually returning back to London in 1870, where she lived in Marylebone. It's thought that she returned to the lure of the Franco-Prussian War, thinking that she might be able to help once again. She even contacted Sir Harry Verney, the husband of Florence Nightingale's sister, Parthenope, who I am related to somehow, but I forget exactly how. Henry Verney was closely involved with the British National Society for the Relief of the Sick and Wounded. And Florence heard about this, heard about Mary contacting him, and wrote Harry a letter saying, "I had the greatest difficulty in repelling Miss Seacole's advances, and in preventing association between her and my nurses, absolutely out of the question. Anyone who employs Mrs. Seacole will introduce much kindness, also much drunkenness and improper conduct." So Florence apparently was just not a fan of Mary. Could this be a touch of racism? Probably. Not that this would matter too much to Mary though, who was now on the outskirts of the British royal circle. The royals were big fans of Mary. She treated many members of the family whilst in the Crimea. Count Glycan even carved a marble bust of Mary that was exhibited at the Royal Academy in 1872, a huge honour. She was even the personal masseuse of the Princess of Wales. But despite this, Mary was still poor, and as time went on, she received less and less recognition for her work. She died on the 14th of May 1991 at her home in Paddington in London. Her cause of death listed as apoplexy, bleeding of the internal organs. She was buried at St Mary's Roman Catholic Cemetery in Kensal Green in London, just a very short obituary posted in the Times on her life. And then for 100 years, she was forgotten, the British public moving on to other things. Until a group of nurses in the Caribbean, where she was much better remembered, visited her grave in London in 1973. This was brought to the attention of the local MP, who promised to raise money for a statue of Mary, and her gravestone was restored. From then on, people began to pay more attention to the story and the legacy of Mary Seacole. Her story began to be told once again, and thanks to the autobiography that she published while still alive, anyone curious about her could go and find out all about her life and who she was. Mary wasn't ever going to be a mysterious historical figure. Everything was there, her incredible feats and her feisty personality, all down in writing in her book. Nowadays, there are many British buildings and organisations that commemorate her. There's the Mary Seacole Centre for Nursing Practice at the Thames Valley University. There's the Mary Seacole Research Centre at De Montfort University, and the Mary Seacole Building at Brunel University. In fact, loads of universities have buildings named after her. If you're a uni student, let me know if your university is one of them. Just earlier this year, the NHS Seacole Centre in Surrey was opened, a community hospital to provide rehabilitation for patients recovering from COVID-19. In 2016, a statue of Mary was unveiled in the grounds of St Thomas's Hospital in London, and there's the Mary Seacole Trust, ensuring that she'll never be lost to history again. The fact that this incredible, badass woman was lost to history is a tragedy in the first place. I'm sure the fact that she was a black woman did contribute to this. She was just never given the opportunities that Florence Nightingale was. Of course, Florence was going to be the one that was remembered. But then again, it's not only about the colour of her skin. Florence was from a wealthy family. She grew up with money and connections. She was always going to have that privilege. Mary didn't even grow up in the UK, and whilst her name was known well amongst the working class soldiers, she never quite had these societal connections that Florence did. Mary did have the royal connections, but Florence was close with Queen Victoria herself. There was only space for one Crimean nurse to be remembered, and of course, it was going to be Florence Nightingale. It was never going to be Mary. Not that I'm saying Florence shouldn't have been remembered, she did do incredible things in her own right, and she's remembered for a very good reason. And as I said in the video, at the end of the day, they had very different missions, but they should have just been remembered alongside each other, their names synonymous. Some people argue that race wasn't the reason why Mary was forgotten, that her story has just been exaggerated over the years by word of mouth, that she doesn't deserve the pride of place that she's been given in recent years. Regardless of what those people would say, based on her book, I would say that she's a pretty cool woman worthy of remembering. Mary now has pride of place on my 5 people I would love to invite to a dinner party list. Like, what I would give to have a single conversation with this woman, because I'm sure she has some incredible stories to tell. Like the pure nerve and confidence it takes for her to go to all of the right people in London to be told that no, she can't go over and help with the war effort, and then say, screw it, I'm gonna do it myself. And she did, and the soldiers loved her for it. Thank you so much for watching this video. I'm really sorry about the horrendous lighting. I didn't think it was gonna be this bad, but apparently it is, and editing me is going to be infuriated, I'm sure. I'm really sorry, but hopefully the story still comes across. Thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Bye, guys.